So
they withdraw their
opposition to number 3, 128 James being added to the list of historical resources.
They were all opposing them?
I guess so.
They withdrew.
Councilor Gervasi, we've had a withdrawal to the opposition for item 3, the historical building.
Excellent.
So we now have the authority to do it.
Okay.
I made a copy for you.
How does that work?
Thank you very much.
I'm still getting used to the new rules, so if somebody opposes that.
If there's any kind of opposition, then we have to go to council to make the final decision.
Right, but now we can make a decision here.
Now we can be, if
unless
everybody
there's opposition,
is in,
yeah, unless if everyone's in support. Okay, I understand.
Or the committee doesn't concur in the...
If the committee, yeah, obviously if we want
then
it.
Then it'd be...
Okay, got it. Why can I not? Oh, because I'm not doing this right. I don't have my computer on yet.
Meeting to order January 26, 2015, Standing Committee on Downtown Development, Heritage, and Riverbank Management. I'll be chairing today's meeting. I'm Brian Mays. I'm the City Councilor for St. Vital Ward, joined by my colleagues, Councilor Brawadi, Councilor Gervasi, Councilor Erlico, as well as Ms. Marks from the City Clerk staff, and a variety of all-star city staff are here with us today, as well as the Mayor's Office. Thank you for attending. I'm told we're live streaming, so I think Howard, who was it? It was Foster Hewitt used to start his first broadcast with good evening hockey fans in the United States, Canada, and Newfoundland. So we'll start the same way. And good evening to watchers in the United States, Canada, and Newfoundland and Labrador.
I'm not sure.
So I think we have to approve the, it was the 1920s. Newfoundland was a separate nation. We have to approve the minutes, Madam Clerk. So we'll approve the minutes. Moved by Councillor Gervasi. Any commentary? All those in favor? Contrary? Carried. And we have no delegations?
No delegations.
All right. And we have a withdrawal of the opposition as listed in number 3, I believe.
Yes.
So we'll be adding a fourth item to the bottom of the agenda. So unless there are further procedural matters, we'll turn to item number 1, where I understand there's a request for a layover. But Mr. Pite or Mr. Kiernan, perhaps you can speak to that.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. On this item, Mr. Kiernan will be requesting a 60-day extension of time to report back, but he can provide you an update on his progress thus far.
It's the Intelligent Communities designation that the City of Winnipeg was part of. In essence, we'd be meeting with we'll be meeting to get follow-up this week with Economic Development in Winnipeg. We had originally thought when we came to committee before that banners and sort of sign toppers and things would be a reasonable way to commemorate this designation and award. In conversation, we actually thought about it. We think we have a better answer that shows a more intelligent approach. So it'll be a combination of the physical, the park, and the as I would say, broadband. And so we're meeting to discuss that. There's sort of 6 categories. There's people first, green innovations, our innovations, design excellence, and economic development. So we're mirroring it with sort of the criteria that under which we won the award wasn't for banners and sign toppers. It was for all the other innovations that the City of Winnipeg and city businesses undertake. So we like to partner with Economic Development Winnipeg and for March, April implementation of that commemoration celebration.
This sounds like an intelligent approach. I will move 68 over.
Sounds good.
And we talked earlier about three or four of the universities being involved, U of M, UW, St. Boniface. Yes,
yeah,
good. Okay.
And the colleges as well.
Very good.
So it's the, basically it's based on physical, social, and digital, and we thought we'd bring it back that way as the best way to commemorate.
Okay. So, Councilor Barwadi, you moved layover.
60 days, yeah.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, that's carried. Item number two.
Item
again
two,
with
again be requesting a 60-day timeline to report back.
A work in progress, and with the adoption by council in June of 2014 of the new heritage bylaw, one of the challenges and tasks we had identified for ourselves was to move forward related to the, for lack of a better term, demolition by neglect that sometimes occurs. And so what we've done is we've taken a working group, looked at the vacant and derelict buildings bylaw, the neighborhood livability, and we will probably, with advice from legal services, be coming back to, rather than amend those bylaws, look at amending this spring again the heritage resources bylaw as the best means to contain the
issues. Come back around to that.
We've kind of come full circle based on sort of the legal and those implications. Currently, there's about 18 buildings that might fall into either vacant, and most of them are vacant as opposed to derelict, that would fall into that. So it's probably more, for an implementation perspective, more easily contained within the heritage buildings and resources bylaw. So we're working through with legal, and we'll report back in 60 days on that.
Because I remember when the bylaw was passed, there was a time frame that it was something we didn't want to get lost in terms of, because it wasn't included in the new bylaw, and the assurance was that it was going to be dealt with. And so I appreciate, you know, you're working on this, and hopefully it won't get delayed too long, because it's been a long-term issue, obviously, in the city. But.
And we're still using the existing bylaws that are in place. We think there's probably an enhanced answer rather than just vacant or a derelict bylaw, or the neighborhood livability, that it's contained, and it's easier to have it tied together from a legal perspective if it's all in one bylaw. So that's been the recommendation.
I guess if I don't, you don't mind, I just have one. I guess I have my concern too, like, is there anything in the vacant bylaw that is like a problem in terms of, you know, saying that a heritage building has to be torn down if it doesn't meet, if it's designated under heritage, it should be protected from that?
Correct, and we've linked the heritage bylaw with the vacant and derelict bylaws as well to make sure that doesn't happen. Okay. The issue really is there's an anticipated enhanced level of, we're really dealing with public safety on those two bylaws. With the heritage buildings, we're dealing with some key elements and components that may need ongoing maintenance that are different from, is it just unsafe? So it's kind of that, an additional layer of nuance we have to sort through.
Okay, thank you. I would move the, so you're asking for a layover?
Yes.
Of how long?
60 days.
Okay, I would move that.
Sure.
Okay.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary, that's carried. Item number three.
And so there's, given there's no opposition to this, this is something that was recommended by the Historical Resources and Buildings Committee and the administration as well, of the department as well. So I would move that unless anybody has an issue with it. Looks good to me.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Now, our additional item is, and I want to thank Mr. Pite for being able to respond on fairly short notice on this item, so thank you for that. This item being, we wanted to get an update to find out what has been happening since April of 2014, when there's a bit of a history here, back and forth between different committees. Councillor Gerbasi, I think, having been the link between both committees, in essence, a motion having been passed at infrastructure that was referred to here, and then follow-up requested from the administration. There was no specific time frame.
Yeah, the motion specifically said at the appropriate time. Our lead on this is Mr. Gary Holmes, who's our Manager of Economic Development. And Gary's provided a quick update for committee on where we're at in terms of the elements of the motion.
Good morning.
Morning.
Yeah, so just in short, to review the April direction, it came in with four component parts, the first two specifically being dealt with by PP&D, and that was to initiate discussions with the applicable property owners at the intersection of Portage and Main regarding the implementation of an at-grade pedestrian crossing at that intersection, including potentially amending existing agreements. So, legal agreements are in place, as you know, with this between the city and the property owners, and have expirations in 4 years, in 2019. There's also 40-year renewal clauses associated with those leases, and we have been exploring that the impact of at-grade crossing on existing retail is the most relevant factor in pursuing those further discussions with the property owners, given that that was the intent of the original agreements. The second component of the direction was to engage with stakeholders to include consultations and research as applicable. We were able to tap some outside expertise in terms of retail in the downtown, retail recruitment possibilities, and expand the scope to include the applicability to Portage and Main, and specifically Portage and Main-oriented underground retail. And got some preliminary findings on observations that we're intending to include in a more comprehensive information package. But specifically, we were looking at elements that would support underground retail and pedestrianization at grade, and explore with expertise whether more people at the intersection equaled more retail opportunity and advantage. We also looked at the wayfinding and connectivity aspect of things, because that's within our policy framework for the downtown, and wondered whether we could leverage the identity of the intersection, its notoriety and its history, et cetera, both from a citizen and a visitor standpoint, whether or not it could in fact serve as a downtown wayfinding compass that would orientate people better to the downtown more broadly, and whether wayfinding signage could be introduced to promote connectivity to destination districts in the downtown, again, consistent with our policy. In terms of looking at specific design elements and infrastructure that currently exists, we conducted a physical site visit just to do some preliminary observations. We found that some of the existing barriers could be adapted for pedestrians potentially, that of course there were adjacent public plazas that could be enhanced. There were potential access enhancements to the underground concourse that might be in play. Certain locations at grade, there were locations for pedestrian-oriented wayfinding signage to be potentially introduced, and that in walking around from a visitor perspective, there were some intuitive gateways, view sheds, and connecting corridors that could be further leveraged in relation to the at-grade orientation of the intersection. And just wanted to note that clearly within downtown policy, there's support for ongoing and enhanced downtown vibrancy and pedestrian orientation. So from a departmental perspective, we see there's lots of merit in continuing to look at this from a planning and policy perspective, but also appreciating the very critical component, and the other two components of the direction relate more specifically to the public works jurisdiction. So we're mindful of the report that previously went forward to the Infrastructure Standing Committee, and that the intersection is currently used as a high-volume regional traffic corridor. There's also unique geometry and complex traffic movement aspects to the intersection that would have to be further studied, again, through transit and public works. We believe that the third component of the direction was to undertake in advance a detailed traffic analysis, and that would be led by Public Works, and that we could, upon completion of that, leverage our integrated planning model and work through our peak group to further discuss and bring the information components together for further consideration from Standing Committee and Council. And fourthly, the direction to explore in more detail financing options and operating and maintenance costs. Clearly, there's more information that we require in order to look at that. The information that we additionally need would be a prerequisite to that piece of information if you would need to make a decision. And that's pretty much in a nutshell. the work that we've done to date.
Councillor Perwadi had his hand up, and then Councillor Gervasi.
First, it's just a quick question to Gary. My understanding is a number of the property holders of Portage and Main have, like you say, the 4 years and then this 40-year renewal. That's at their discretion, right? Or can we step in at this point and say, hey, 4 years from now, you don't get that option to renew? Is it both parties have to agree, or just one has to?
I'd have to seek further clarity on that. I guess strategically, if we wanted to do something in terms of introducing pedestrian crossing, we would have to be mindful of that renewal clause being present in the agreements right now.
Okay. Well, again, I'd like to thank Gary. I mean, your orders were to go and start looking at these things, but also as part of negotiating. Have there been discussions about whether they intend to renew their leases in 4 years?
No, not at this point directly with respect to that.
So have there been negotiations or discussions with the property holders?
No.
Okay, so that part of our instructions hasn't been followed to this point.
Yeah, we would have to, again, advance direct negotiations or opportunities with the help of legal services.
Regardless, I think it's no problem that you haven't done that. I think we are so far ahead of the horse is so far ahead of this thing. I mean, in some utopian world where, you know, we could, you know, move traffic around our downtown, where we could continue to move traffic through Portage and Main, you know, the volumes that are there, great. But, I mean, it would be completely and utterly irresponsible, I think, of this council to tear down this wall and just put up pedestrian signals. Again, I understand Portage and Main closed in 1977, which was the year I was born, so I don't personally remember running across Portage and Main, obviously. But, again, I've heard horror stories from people who did do it, and apparently it was just, you know, it's always been, and as far as I can tell, will for a long term be a major traffic thoroughfare. I mean, if we had infinite amounts of money, I could see, you know, doing some sort of overpass or opening up Portage and Main, you know, to the elements to some degree, you know, with an underground. I mean, there's ways you could potentially open it and make it easier to cross, but, you know, still under the street. Just as it is, I mean, it just seems completely ridiculous. And I mean, it's good to, you know, I believe it's the right track to, you know, consider the ramifications to underground retail. But again, for the couple dozen people that want to cross Portage and Main in January versus the thousands of people that drive through it every day, it just, in my mind, doesn't make sense at this point. So I think we're just wasting a lot of time and energy on this particular exercise, Mr. Chairman, respectfully.
Inconsistent, Councillor Boyd. Councillor DeBrasse.
I think Councillor Brody referred to himself as a one-man army this morning earlier against this, but it takes more than one man to build an army, I kind of quipped back. But I think there's been a cultural change in Winnipeg since 1977. I certainly hope so, and I think if we're going to make political speeches, then I can get to my questions. I think that I don't think it's a utopian world to have your major intersections open to pedestrians. It's the world of every other city in the world, pretty much. We're the only ones who do this. So it's not ridiculous. What's ridiculous is what we've been doing for the last 35 years. And we need, and so, you know, we have different positions. Obviously, this is an issue not everyone on council agrees with. Not everyone in Winnipeg agrees with. We know that. Not everybody is on the same page on this issue. But we have a mayor who ran on this, since we're talking politics now, and we have a number of legitimate motions and processes through council, which were not reckless and were not ridiculous. First, we went to Public Works and asked them to do a preliminary look, and that was in, I have the report here from way back in March, and there's reports that go back to 2007. I mean, I have all the reports here. This is not just a frivolous exercise. And there's support for this from all the major downtown stakeholders. There's an understanding, there's a report for the support for the principles of what this would mean by the department, by our city plan, in the sense of putting pedestrians as a priority and engaging and having a vibrant downtown. The impact of having this intersection closed kills a part of our downtown. It's dead space. It's not a dozen people. We're talking about thousands of people. I don't know the numbers, but I mean, it will be amazing to reopen Portage Main. And frankly, it's an embarrassment across the country when I try to explain what is happening in Winnipeg to various national leaders who've asked me about it. You know, what? You have Portage Main closed? Isn't that what Winnipeg stands for? Is Portage and Main an iconic intersection? So thanks for giving me the liberty to make a political speech, but I do have some questions. One which is the retail study. I'm wondering. My understanding was the intention of that was, you know, to, are we getting some evidence to show the real impact? Like, I think we should do this on an evidence-based way. I don't think, you know, we all have our opinions, but this motion asks for evidence, and so that evidence, I take it, will be coming? I mean, is it in the works?
It'll be coming.
When will it be coming, I guess, is what I'm wondering. As part of a whole comprehensive report, when do you see that report being ready?
Because a component of it pertains to some necessary work that needs to be done through Public Works and Transit, I would just assume, okay, defer to our higher decision-making authorities to determine
time. So you can't really answer. I think it's hard to tell how quickly this is going to move. This motion said when appropriate, at the appropriate time, and I mean, I wrote the motion, so I understand why it said that. And it said that because we have a delicate legal issue that we don't want to jeopardize. We want to make sure we can work with the stakeholders, that we can work with the property owners, and it's a little more complex than it might seem. There's leaseholders in there too. Like, there's a very complex legal issue to resolve, and I don't think we should try to start talking about that here. We need to not jeopardize it. But in terms of stakeholders, it also says engage with stakeholders. I can assure you that the downtown biz, Center Venture, the Forks, all the major downtown organizations are very committed to this. They understand the importance of this, as I see does our city department, as I see our mayor, as I see a number of members of council and the majority of members of the committees that have dealt with this over the years. So this is not ridiculous. So I just want to say that. In terms of, I remember having discussions with this about the previous director, and it was my understanding that there were some sort of discussions going on about this. I mean, are you essentially saying that no discussions have happened at all? Like, maybe no formal official ones? Are we doing anything on this number one here? Because my understanding was that we were, and so I am a bit wondering, you know, is it just stuff that we can't discuss because there's legal stuff and we just need to wait till you're ready? If that's the answer, I can accept that answer. But if we just aren't doing anything. Like, is this in process? Is this going to be happening?
Yes, in the first and foremost.
That's the real issue.
Yes.
And that's all I was concerned about. I understand we can't talk about sensitive negotiations in public. We want to be transparent, and that's very important. But at the same time, this is a precarious thing that has to be worked out. And when it's worked out, then we can hopefully come forward with something really positive for the community, that has the support of the community and the stakeholders, and I would hope that the other stakeholders are involved in terms of the downtown ones as well in this. Okay. And I also, this was also intentionally put in an order of steps, you know, so obviously the issue of whether we can do this or not is important, that's being looked at. Engaging the stakeholders, there's going to be the research, there's going to be the traffic study, and I understand we were going to wait till we sorted out some of these earlier pieces before we ask for the more detailed traffic study. Is that what we're doing as well, just for clarification? Because it'd be a lot of money to go and do some of these other studies. We want to see if we, is that what the administration?
There'd be a twofold opportunity. At the very least, we'd want to mobilize upon expiration of the existing leases, at the very least. If there's an opportunity to do some stuff beforehand as a result of engaging with the property owners, we would certainly be mobilized to do that as well, yes. But we wanted to do it based on some expertise around impacts on underground retail and at-grade crossings, because that we suspected that would be front and center.
Because I think this motion gives the, when this motion was passed, I was really pleased because it essentially gave the administration the power to go forth and bring us back this information that we need to make that ultimately council's going to decide. Like, Councillor Barwadi will have his day to make his case about if he doesn't like what the report says when it comes back, and as each of us will, right? But I think to sort of stop the work of going ahead and examining this with something which I, you know, I hear being even spoken of concerns me, because
you figure out the traffic first and then deal with the pedestrians. In this case.
Figure out the traffic first and then deal with the pedestrians. Why?
Okay. In this case.
I think that kind
that's
of says
what
it all.
That's what I was saying.
I think that everything is linked, pedestrians and traffic. So, If you want to go ahead and do the study now, you know, I'm fine with that too, Jeff. But I'm trying to actually be fiscally prudent and responsible and do the other things first. But if that's what you'd like to do, I'd be more than willing to. I'm not sitting up there in the room with the budget figuring out how much money we have. So I don't have that ability to know if we can afford that.
Shut all the roads down, Jenny.
I don't think I'm suggesting that. So the point is that I think the direction is already here. Councillor Mazin's brought it forward. And I'm pleased you've got us an update, and I guess that's really about it. We don't have a timeline. We don't have the, it may not be something we can put a precise timeline on, but I don't want it to sit in limbo forever either. So.
No, and we have a timeline in a sense, and that the mayor has said he wants reopening by 2019 at the latest. What I would like to see, your motion, though, made a lot of sense with sort out the legal basis first before you do it. Traffic study. I think that's fair. Maybe I'm going to have a question for you, Brad, in a moment or so here.
And I would have traffic, went out before doing a more detailed traffic study.
But I would like, I do think we need to get clarity and within a meeting or two we're being told there are four separate agreements with the four corner stakeholders, and in the interest of transparency, can we get those, or at least a summary of those? And I don't need to know if Northwest Corner is fine and Southwest says never. I don't think we need that, and that may be internal legal stuff. But
in the absence of legal, that might be an in-camera conversation, detailed discussion about existing leases with a third party. So,
well, not so much the leases as we know there were agreements signed in 1979 with a 40-year term, hence 2019. We're also being told there's a renewal clause. We need to know if that's entirely at the discretion of the property owners. I've seen different information here about. It certainly wasn't the last council. It had, if there was an automatic renewal clause at the discretion of the last holder, it certainly predates the last council. I think it predates Councillor Gervasi's term in office. It goes back
30 years ago.
Like not
30. I think it does.
My sense was there was an original set of negotiations and a subsequent set, but all of that's 30 to 40 years ago. So, if we could get something back on who we have these agreements with and that issue of. Because that's a pretty important first step. If someone's got an automatic right of renewal, we'll need to know that, frankly. I think that the sequencing makes a lot of sense here. And I support the mayor's position to try and get this reopened, but I do think we need to know sort of what hurdles there might be, what barriers there might be to removing the barriers. So if we can find that out, that would certainly be useful. And I had a question for Brad, whose staff did a lot of work, which I appreciate, on that report that we got in April. My one question, though, was to find out I've been looking at the Master Transportation Plan, and there are a couple of references in there to a BRT route that would be in place before 2030, 2031, that would go straight down Main. No dog leg, so luckily we won't have that to deal with. So straight up and down Main, the starting point of that, there seem to be two different discussions in the document about that. But just want to be clear, there hasn't been any work, I'm presuming, done on that. What I don't want us to do is go off on a whole discussion of the reopening for pedestrians, and then, you know, 5 years later have somebody say, oh, well, what we need to do is, in order to have a viable rapid transportation link going through, we need to close this. You see where I'm going with this. So any thought been given to that BRT link?
I can't tell you with certainty that that no further thought from a transit planning perspective within the transit department has been done. I'm not aware of anything significant because it has such a long time frame out. However, it is anticipated that there would be a high likelihood for a need for that link from a rapid transit perspective in the future. The reality is that at some point the transit movements through that intersection are going to increase with or without rapid transit. And if we're talking rapid transit at grade through that intersection, there's a lot of different ways it could look. It could be elevated. It could have its own dedicated lane. There's all kinds of things that you can do. The reality is there's consequences to the other types of traffic that use the intersection, no matter what you do. So in terms of the level of planning that would tell us whether it would be a go or no go, that hasn't been done. I can't think of any reason why it wouldn't be possible in the future. You know, right now, that intersection carries about, there's 44 different routes and about 560 transit vehicles who go through that intersection today without rapid transit. So whatever happens in the intersection in terms of pedestrians has to have a key component when it comes to all transit. And I just want to remind everybody, I heard a little bit of the discussion of, you know, look at traffic first and then pedestrians. They are absolutely inseparable. When you look at traffic through that intersection, we're talking about transit, we're talking about pedestrians, we're talking about cars, we're talking about emergency access, we're talking about all of those things. Everything that moves to that intersection, you cannot separate them, they are coupled. So we can't just look at what would happen with pedestrians there without looking at what the impacts, not just in the intersection, but what they would be globally around the intersection because of the 78,000 vehicles a day that right now go through that intersection. So they're all tied, and it's a very complex dance, so to speak, that you go through when you try to move a significant amount of pedestrians potentially at grade through an intersection where you have an enormous amount of traffic at grade with all of the mix. So it's a very interesting problem to make that work well.
I have a question. Is this the only intersection in the entire, almost on the entire globe, that has this problem, or is it like other intersections in major cities everywhere in the world, including every city in Canada that has major intersections with lots of lanes and lots of cars going through?
I think you have a wide cross-section. There are certainly major intersections in the world where you wouldn't find pedestrians simply because of, you know, the large roundabouts that you see in some of the cities. It would be impossible for any jurisdiction to invite pedestrians to try and cross some of those. Crossings below, crossings above for pedestrians. There's a wide.
They do, and I'm not trying to say they don't exist, that there's pedestrians, there's intersections close to pedestrians. But of this size, it's certainly something you see in many cities. I mean, could we look at what other cities do in similar types of intersections? Is that part of what we're looking at too, or we would look at in a study like this? Because it seems to me, I've been to London, I've been to Paris, I've been to many North American cities, as many of us have, and you see pretty large intersections that are full of pedestrians, New York City. And yeah, the 1970s, I'm hoping, is 40 years, 45 years ago. I wasn't on council then, by the way. I was a little kid.
To answer your question, absolutely, we look at what has worked and what hasn't worked in other jurisdictions. There are jurisdictions that have restricted one or more movements of pedestrians in an intersection and then gone back because of the traffic impacts. Mm-hmm. Even in this study, when we looked at the report that we brought forward in March, there was a movement of pedestrians that we were strongly recommending against, if in fact it was ever opened up, simply because of the conflicts and putting the pedestrians and motorists at risk. So you find varying degrees of pedestrian movement through intersections.
Well, and I guess I challenge the Public Works Department. Obviously, you have to look at this scientifically, and you have to look at the traffic and everything, but you also have to look at all the other factors, which the planning department, for example, is looking at other factors, like the fact that this is the most iconic intersection in Winnipeg, and the number of people who would go there, and the impacts on the downtown if it was full of pedestrians as opposed to a tumbleweed rolling down there. And that whole part, I understand totally what your bailiwick is, but I think we need to be looking at this from all of those perspectives. and that's important. So I appreciate your perspective is completely valid in the sense that the principles of the idea make sense from a planning perspective. So I think we have to look at all those perspectives. I agree with you on that.
Absolutely, and I would just say, when it comes to the technical aspects, people talk about the engineers are just looking at the traffic. Engineers, by profession, are responsible for looking after the well-being of the citizenry in whatever area they practice. So we, by training and by law, are not able to just look at one aspect. We have to take everything into account, just as our counterparts in the other departments take ours into account. Overall, we have to find a way to make it work. If it's the will of council and the contractual things are worked out and Portage Avenue is to be open to pedestrians at some point in the future, that report that we provided in March showed how it could be done with pedestrians moving at grade. We also talked about what the consequences would be from a traffic perspective. And that's valuable information for everybody to have.
Of course. That's why we asked for that report. Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you.
So can we get back then at least that I would like to get an update in 60 days on just the legal, what the legal framework here is in terms of these, we hear about these four agreements, but
yeah.
I'd like to get some more clarity on what it is we're dealing with in terms of the four agreements.
Mr. Chairperson, I think that update's important. I also think there might be a need. We should perhaps check with legal if that has to be in camera in terms of protecting the real possibility of, as much as I value transparency very, very much, it's not being transparent to protect the city's interests until such time as these things can be made public while we're working through a negotiation. And I think, we have to remember that. So I just want to protect that interest at the same time as moving forward. Does I appreciate having that briefing? But I think we also have to make sure that we don't jeopardize the chances of this ever happening by just,
I'm just going to say again, Mr. Chairman, if I may, keeping the 78,000 plus vehicles moving every day, the 44 transit routes, making sure we had to figure out the logistics of all of that, I think has to come before we start going and trying to sign deals with the property owners. And I think, again, I'm going to have to vote against this motion here today.
The motion is for us to provide an update on where we're at in terms of negotiations. And
I think we should cease and desist right now, and I think it's more of a public works issue than a property matter at this point.
But aren't we?
There's a council motion.
I mean, if somebody can trigger a 40-year blocking, if somebody can trigger a 40-year right of renewal to say you can't take down the barrier,
okay.
I'm not telling Brad to do any more work, forthwith.
Okay, sure. I'll support. That's fair.
Okay. Really? That. Won you over with that? That's impressive.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Monday morning.
All right. So, and just for, okay. So, for clarity, I do agree with the mayor on this in terms of trying to get reopening and also trying to pursue the BRT routes. I don't want to sound like I'm on record as opposing that. I think those are actually two pretty good initiatives. It's just we got to the two of them need to be considered at the same time. Okay, so the follow-up then is a request for an update in camera if necessary.
Yeah, and let our legal department advise us on that. I mean, I'm all for transparency. I move the motions on the audits, but we got to be real here. We can't just suddenly have every legal issue completely aired in public in the middle of a sensitive negotiation. Like we got to have a balance here. There is a time for that, and I think we have to realize that, and as soon as things can be made public, they should be.
Okay.
But I think we have to protect the city's interest.
And there's we aren't on record here as saying whether any negotiations we have not entered into negotiations.
So I just want to I think we should all I'm saying is we should check with legal before and just make sure we're safe.
Okay.
Sounds
good.
Jeopardizing.
All right. We're clear on that, Madam Clerk?
Yeah.
Okay, everybody okay with that?
Yep.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
And it was Councillor Gervasi that moved that?
Aye.
Sure.
Believe it was.
Okay.
Right. Any further points of business?
Thank you for bringing this forward, Brian.
No problem.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You for responding on fairly short notice. So we'll have a move by Councillor Orlico to adjourn. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Thank you, councilors.
Thank you.